Our dean recently seemed to muse aloud whether you had advanced knowledge of 9/11. Do you agree or disagree with the RNC that this kind of rhetoric borders on political hate speech?
Look, there's time for politics. And, you know, it's time for politics. And it's an absurd insinuation.
Many Americans consider the September 11th terrorist attack to be the single worst crime ever carried out on U.S. soil. Yet because it was labeled an act of war instead of a crime against humanity, a proper criminal inquiry has never been made into the attack. Many believe that such an investigation is warranted to probe three important aspects of the attack. 1. Is there evidence of official foreknowledge or preparation before the attack? 2. Is there evidence of official misconduct during the attack? And 3. Is there evidence of official cover-up or obstruction after the attack? In this presentation, we will conduct our own mock investigation. We will look at the evidence in the form of photos, videos, official documents, and witness testimony. We will identify suspects, motives, and if there were any historical precedents for these accusations. All that we ask is that you take an objective look at the evidence we present and decide for yourself if a new investigation is warranted. It can reasonably be argued that no other event in American history has altered American foreign and domestic policy as radically as the attack of 9/11. The wars in Afghanistan and Iraq have not only had a huge cost in hundreds of thousands of human lives, but has justified the spending of billions in defense dollars every year at a time when America faces an economic crisis. The fear and hysteria over the 9/11 attack has also convinced the American people to trade their liberties for security, as Congress passed the Patriot Act and Homeland Security bills, which has effectively nullified important parts of the First, Fourth, and Sixth Amendments of the Constitution, while granting the federal government an unprecedented level of secrecy and unaccountability. The 9/11 attack has also been used to justify violations of the Geneva Convention, including torture, kidnapping, holding people without charge or legal representation, and secret prisons overseas where suspects can be beaten, sometimes to death, all in the name of American security. Despite all of these drastic changes in American policy, the only in-depth public investigation into the 9/11 attack was from the 9/11 Commission. But how accurate was their report?
I think a lot of people, Jesse, figure, well, you know, that 9/11 report came out and it said it was those guys over there. It was those Al-Qaeda guys.
In the summer of 2004, the 9/11 Commission report was finally released to the public and was immediately touted by the media as the final authoritative word on the events surrounding 9/11. Unfortunately, the media ignored criticisms of the report, even from members of the commission itself.
Lee and I write in our book that we think the commission in many ways was set up to fail, because we had not enough money, we didn't have enough time, we'd been appointed by the most partisan people in Washington, the leaders of the House and Senate.
The precedent for opening an immediate congressional investigation has been clearly established in almost every major event, from airline crashes to assassinations, in order to determine exactly what happened. Pearl Harbor, the investigation was ordered in 9 days. JFK assassination, investigation ordered in 7 days. The Challenger disaster, investigation opened in 7 days. Yet the investigation into the most devastating terrorist attack of our time was not started for 14 months after the fact. That's over a year for any guilty parties to destroy evidence, develop alibis, and to cover their trail. Both the President and Vice President went to Senate Majority Whip Tom Daschle and requested that there not be a full inquiry into 9/11, and then spent the next year obstructing any attempt for a congressional inquiry. Dick Cheney even threatened congressional Democrats that if they pressed for a 9/11 investigation, they could be charged with interfering with the war on terror. Once public pressure finally forced the creation of the 9/11 Commission, it was severely underfunded and manipulated by Bush insider Philip Zelikow, who had final word on which topics would and would not be investigated. Large sections of the report were based on the transcripts of prisoners who we now know were being tortured for information. The Commission staff were not allowed to see or speak to any of these witnesses. Evidence and testimony that contradicted the official story was either altered or completely ignored in the final report. In fact, in the book 9/11 Commission Report, Omissions and Distortions, David Ray Griffith documents over 100 times where relevant information was manipulated, including the testimonies from FBI whistleblowers, government officials, and other witnesses who challenged the Bush administration's versions of events. In late 2003, 9/11 Commissioner Max Cleland resigned from the panel in frustration, calling the investigation a whitewash, after the White House refuses to turn over subpoenaed documents.
The president has said only a minority of the commission can see a minority of the documents, and then they have to clear what they're going to say to the rest of the commission with the White House.
If you're one of those four that gets to see these documents, would that change your opinion?
No. They don't want any more eyeballs to see their documents than they can possibly get away with. It's a scam. It's absolutely disgusting.
By 2006, even more than 9/11 commissioners had come forward to say that they had been deliberately misled by Pentagon and aviation officials. Commission Chairman Tom Keene himself said that what they were told was just so far from the truth.
The troubling part of the story is officials with both NORAD and the FAA continued to give inaccurate information about the attacks for 2 years after 9/11.
But if even the 9/11 commissioners themselves believe that the official report was falsified, does this not alone justify the call for a new and more aggressive investigation into the 9/11 attack?
We need to remind ourselves that this commission's task was to investigate the murder of nearly 3,000 persons. And while the commission published a final report, there is today widespread skepticism among the American public about the commission's report. And many voices are calling for keeping the investigation alive.
The fact remains that the policies enacted and the war started as a direct result of the 9/11 attack continue even now, as the Bush administration is no longer in power. Not until the truth of 9/11 is found and exposed will we be able to repeal these policies that have encroached our civil rights, end the wars that continue to kill our troops and many innocent civilians, and bring all of those who participated in the attack to justice, ensuring that a tragedy like this will never happen again. While one of the most important freedoms we have in America is the right to freely discuss and debate important topics, the media and self-described skeptics openly attack people who dare to question the validity of the 9/11 story.
Anybody who thinks that 9/11 was carried out by the government isn't a truther. They're idiots.
But when it comes to 9/11, are you so sure?
No.
That, okay.
No, but I ask questions, and what perturbs me is that you don't get answers. Nobody wants to talk about it. This event that changed our entire history of our country, why aren't we allowed to discuss it? Why aren't we allowed to ask questions? The moment you do, you get a reaction like he gave me. How dare you? Tells you you're crazy, calls you Rosie O'Donnell, insult you. Why? Because I ask questions?
In the ongoing attempts to prevent open discussions of 9/11, several myths have been perpetuated intended to demonize and ridicule 9/11 researchers. The definition of a conspiracy is any time two or more people work together to commit a crime. So by definition, the official 9/11 story, where 19 Al-Qaeda radicals hijack 4 flights, is a conspiracy. Yet the title of conspiracy theorist is only applied to people who question the official story. The title is meant to discredit legitimate questions by associating 9/11 researchers with radical or fringe stereotypes, such as a belief in UFOs, Bigfoot, or Holocaust denial. When noted linguist Noam Chomsky was called a conspiracy theorist, he pointed out that the term is used when authorities don't want you to think about what's really going on. So the negative meaning of the title is intended when he himself refers to 9/11 research as conspiracy theory. But the fact remains that genuine conspiracies happen quite often, and it would be naive to ignore when there is evidence of one. Another often repeated fallacy is that 9/11 researchers blame the government. While responsible 9/11 researchers question the actions of specific individuals who held official positions, to say that we hold the entire federal government with its thousands of employees to blame is a ridiculous straw man meant to make us appear unreasonable. Over the past couple of years, Popular Mechanics, Skeptics Magazine, and several websites have been featured in the mainstream media addressing some of the issues raised by 9/11 researchers, and have done an excellent job in exposing bogus conspiracy claims based on unfounded speculation. But there are several anomalies that have still not been explained, especially surrounding the validity of the NIST report on the collapse of the World Trade Center that has sparked an ongoing debate happening quietly on the internet. On one side of the debate, there are groups like AE 9/11 Truth, who now have over 1,100 certified architects and engineers calling for a new forensic investigation into the collapse of the World Trade Center. In the presentation, 9/11 Blueprint for Truth, AIA-certified architect Richard Gage openly employs the scientific method to examine 10 aspects of controlled demolitions witnessed on 9/11, including the near free-fall collapse speeds and the liquefaction of steel beams witnessed by dozens on Ground Zero and documented in Appendix C of the FEMA report. This evidence is supported by a peer-reviewed report submitted by 9 scientists who document a steel-melting high-tech explosive called nanothermite in every sample they have examined in the World Trade Center dot.
Og samtidig kan man tilsætte andre stoffer, således at nanotermiter både kan virke som noget, der giver en masse varme, men det kan også virke som et meget, meget effektivt sprængstof.
I hvert fald ikke i tvivl om, at materialet har været der.
Ja, det er sådan noget videnskab. Du kan ikke rigtig snyde det, at vi har fundet det, og det er ureagerede termiter.
On the other side of the debate, we have the National Institute for Standards and Technology, or NIST, who not only refused to submit their work for peer review, but also refused to perform the standard NFPA test for explosives and have flatly denied the existence of molten steel at Ground Zero.
Go back to your basic premise that there was a pool of molten steel. I know of absolutely nobody, no eyewitness who said so, nobody who's produced it.
Molten steel running down the channel.
Very intense down there, and actually melted beams where it was molten steel that was being dug out.
The two beams were never initially part of the same structure. Heat literally melted them together.
This fused element of steel, molten steel and concrete and all of these things all fused by the heat. And
I think this is important because it reveals the attitude of the NIST investigators, which is one of willful ignorance.
NIST's evidence is backed up by the skeptical scientific community, who refuse to honestly examine the new evidence presented by AE 9/11 Truth, and mainstream media personalities who promote the idea that anyone who still questions 9/11 is delusional.
Crazy people who still think the government brought down the Twin Towers in a controlled explosion.
Another widely held misconception is the belief that elements within one's own government would never deceive or endanger its own citizens to obtain their political objectives. Unfortunately, that belief is not historically accurate. Germany, August 31st, 1939. Several groups of soldiers dressed in Polish uniforms attack small towns near the Polish border, vandalizing property and terrorizing local civilians. The radio station in Gliwice is overrun, broadcasting an anti-German message in Polish. Publicity about this attack outraged the German people and was used to justify the immediate invasion of Poland starting World War II. It was later exposed that this attack was actually carried out by German soldiers dressed in Polish uniforms as part of a covert operation to create a justification for war against Poland. The deceptive use of staged events known as false flags has been a common tactic throughout history as a way to scare and outrage citizens into accepting things like wars of aggression and unpopular laws. These operations are usually planned and carried out through covert elements within a government, usually associated with the intelligence community. While most Americans would like to believe that their country would have no involvement in such actions that are so sinister, the CIA has had a long documented history of not only false flag operations, but political assassinations, election rigging, the smuggling of illegal arms and narcotics, as well as the training and support for known terrorist groups. Although these criminal actions would have been condemned by most of our publicly elected officials, these plans were carried out secretly because they benefited American political and financial interests.
I believe my government's never lied to me, have they? Let's see, where should we start? The Gulf of Tonkin incident? Now that took us into war in Vietnam. They've now admitted it was a lie. So 58,000 of my generation were killed based upon a lie. But that doesn't count, does it?
What does that have to do with 9/11?
That shows that we will lie to go to war. We've been doing it for years. We will continue to do it.
The most infamous of the American false flag plans that we know about was the 1962 Operation Northwoods. This plan proposed staging terrorist attacks on U.S. citizens, then planting phony evidence to frame Fidel Castro in order to justify the invasion of Cuba. Amazingly, this plan was approved for use by the Joint Chiefs of Staff, although President Kennedy rejected the plan and it was never used. But what if there was an American president who would authorize the use of such a plan? In spring of 2004, the 9/11 Commission requested that President Bush and Vice President Cheney testify in front of the commission. Bush and Cheney refused to cooperate unless they are allowed to testify together without taking an oath, behind closed doors, with no notes taken or records kept.
Mr. President, why are you and the Vice President insisting on appearing together before the 9/11 Commission?
Because the 9/11 Commission wants to ask us questions. That's why we're meeting, and I look forward to meeting with them and answering their questions.
Why you're appearing together rather than separately, which was their request?
Because it's a good chance for both of us to answer questions that the 9/11 Commission is looking forward to asking us, and I'm looking forward to answering them.
President, Vice President of the United States, don't you think they should be able to stand up and speak their own words?
They should go under oath.
They should be, yeah, in public.
Don't you think that the families deserve to have a transcript or to be able to see what
you said? You asked me that question yesterday. I got the same answer, yeah.
These were the two men who held the highest positions of power and trust in our nation. Why would they refuse to publicly testify under oath if they didn't have something to hide? Most people know George W. Bush as the son of former President Herbert Walker Bush. What most people don't know is that the Bush family and the Saudi bin Laden family have had a close business relationship since the mid-70s through Houston investor James R. Bath, who was the agent for Salam bin Laden's financial interests in Texas. Bath became friends with George W. when they served together in the Texas Air National Guard. But when George Sr. became director of the CIA in 1976, he hired Bath to create offshore companies to move CIA funds through a Pakistani bank called BCCI. BCCI was also used by the CIA and Saudi intelligence to secretly funnel money to Osama bin Laden's Mujahideen to help fight the Soviets in Afghanistan, as well as a little-known Iraqi dictator named Saddam Hussein, before eventually being closed for fraud, money laundering, and corruption. In 1979, George W. Bush launched the Arbusto Oil Company with James Bath's investment from Salam bin Laden, although Arbusto and George W.'s next two oil companies all went bankrupt before George was elected governor of Texas in 1994.
The money that Bath put into Arbusto was nothing but an extension of this quid pro quo relationship between the Saudi royal family and the Bushes. The Saudi royal family was deathly afraid of the Ayatollah Khomeini and the radical Islamic movement. And so at that point in time, they went to the Bushes and said, look, protect us from the Ayatollah and these radical fundamentalists, and we'll give you whatever you want for your campaigns and to fund your kids' business interests to fight your secret wars.
There were other connections between the Bushes and the Saudis. Carlyle Group, which hired both George Bush Jr. and Sr., received major funds and work from Saudi royals and the bin Laden family.
Did nobody in America think that having a president whose family business is oil and defense investments could possibly present a conflict of interest in deciding America's foreign policies? Consider George Bush Sr.'s track record with war. When George Herbert Walker Bush became director of the CIA in 1976, he secretly launched several programs to train and support right-wing terror squads in Colombia, Nicaragua, Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador, who would assassinate union leaders, activist clergy, journalists, while terrorizing innocent civilians with random bloodbaths. In 1983, then-Vice President Bush convinced President Reagan that the small island nation of Grenada posed a threat to American security based on claims that Grenada was constructing a Soviet and Cuban military base and amassing huge weapon stockpiles. Both of these claims were later exposed as false, and the invasion was condemned by the United Nations Security Council as a flagrant violation of international law. The 1986 Iran-Contra investigation uncovered an operation to illegally sell weapons to Iran in order to fund the Contra terrorist group in Nicaragua. Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North, who was working directly under Vice President Bush, stepped forward to take the fall, although he defended his actions by saying he was just following orders. The result was the convictions of 11 defendants, including Colin Powell, John Poindexter, Elliot Abrams, Richard Armitage, John Negroponte, and Mitch Daniels, all of which were later quietly pardoned by Bush Sr., and many returned to work in Bush Jr.'s administration. When Bush Sr. became president, he launched the 1989 invasion of Panama to depose dictator Manuel Noriega, who had been trained at the School of the Americas and was on the CIA's payroll. After the invasion, President Bush proudly announced that the citizens of Panama were liberated from a brutal dictator, even though that dictator was originally supported as an American intelligence asset. Then in 1990, another dictator who enjoyed American covert support, Saddam Hussein, cited Kuwait's practice of slant drilling into Iraq's oil fields as justification for an invasion, after being told by American Ambassador April Glaspie that we have no opinion in Arab conflicts. Yet after the invasion of Kuwait began, President Bush, who had business ties in Kuwait, condemned Saddam Hussein and began campaigning for a military intervention. A woman identified as a nurse working in the Kuwait City Hospital was televised speaking before Congress. She tearfully described Iraqi soldiers pulling babies out of incubators, leaving them to die on the floor. And this created enough public outrage to gain congressional approval for launching Operation Desert Storm. It was later found out that the woman who had testified was the daughter of the Kuwaiti ambassador, who was paid to deliver a false testimony. So is it any real surprise that George Bush Jr. would follow in his father's footsteps of wars justified on false information that violated international law and waged against evil boogeymen who were supported by our own intelligence agencies? Dick Cheney was a longtime friend of the Bush family. In the 1980s, Cheney worked with Don Rumsfeld and Oliver North on Bush Sr.'s secret plan to suspend the Constitution in the case of a national emergency and implement a secret government with a new military chain of command.
Now, going back to the 1980s, in their planning, which bypassed congressional leaders, Cheney was officially no more than a congressman from Wyoming, while Rumsfeld, who at the time was CEO of a drug company, was not officially in the government at all. And yet they were charged to plan for suspension of the American Constitution. The action officer for this secret planning in the 1980s until his dismissal in 1986 was Oliver North, working under Vice President George H.W. Bush in the National Security Council.
Cheney went on to serve as the Secretary of Defense under Bush Sr.'s administration, where he directed the invasion of Panama and the Persian Gulf War, both of which violated United Nations resolutions and were criticized by the international community for war crimes. Following the Gulf War, Dick Cheney then paid a Halliburton subsidiary over $8.5 million to study the use of private military forces with American soldiers in combat zones. Then in 1995, Cheney becomes the CEO of Halliburton and then acquires Dresser Industries, which makes lucrative deals with Saddam Hussein, the dangerous dictator that Cheney had just waged a war against. Cheney is then charged by French authorities for violating the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act by bribing Nigerian officials. Halliburton later pleads guilty to the charges. Now that we have a better understanding of these men, let's take a look at their actions surrounding the 9/11 attack.
Shortly after the end of the Cold War, several major American energy companies began buying up oil supplies in the former Soviet states surrounding the Caspian Sea region. This was an area of expertise for Condoleezza Rice, who served on the board of directors of Chevron Oil as their principal expert on Kazakhstan oil supplies. As of 1992, 50% of all the oil investments in the Caspian Basin were controlled by 11 Western oil companies. But these companies needed a way to transport their oil to a new market opening up in China. So Unocal led a consortium of oil companies in what would become the CentGas, or Central Asian Gas Project. This project proposed building an oil pipeline from Turkmenistan through Afghanistan to the Pakistani coast. The feasibility study for the project was being done by Enron. In 1997, Enron CEO Ken Lay wrote in a letter to Texas Governor George Bush, "This project can bring significant economic opportunities to Texas as well as Uzbekistan." One of the key officials brought in to help facilitate this pipeline was former Secretary of Defense and Halliburton CEO Dick Cheney, who was quoted admitting that the oil and gas in the Caspian is worthless until it's moved, and the only route which makes political and economic sense is through Afghanistan. The problem was getting the Taliban, who were in power in Afghanistan, to go along with the deal. So in 1997, several Taliban leaders were flown to Texas for negotiations, and although they reached a tentative agreement, U.S. officials believed that Afghanistan was still too unstable under Taliban rule to safely build the pipeline. A Unocal spokesman was quoted in the 1998 congressional record stating that the pipeline could not happen until the Taliban were removed from power. It was about this time that former Assistant Secretary of Defense Richard Armitage, who also represented Unocal in the pipeline negotiations, co-authored a National Defense Panel report that advised projecting American military forces into the Middle East to, quote, be involved in regions that control scarce natural resources. Shortly after this report, several hundred American troops were flown into Uzbekistan, an Army Training Command began planning possible scenarios for a military intervention into Afghanistan. Also, as a result of the end of the Cold War, the Pentagon's funding was drastically being cut because they no longer had an enemy to justify their massive budget. In response, William Kristol and Bob Kagan formed the conservative think tank the Project for a New American Century, or PNAC. The underlying goal of the PNAC was to transform our military objectives from defense to offense by using overwhelming military force to establish a Pax Americana in the Middle East and secure American financial interests over the natural resources of that region. Members of the PNAC included Dick Cheney, Don Rumsfeld, Richard Armitage, Paul Wolfowitz, Richard Pearl, Scooter Libby, and many others who would become high-ranking members of George W. Bush's cabinet. In 1998, the PNAC issued an open letter to Bill Clinton calling for a war to remove Saddam Hussein from Iraq. Although Clinton rejected this proposal, in 2000 the PNAC submitted their manifesto, Rebuilding America's Defenses. This report suggests that although the United States faces no global rival, the U.S. military should prepare to rapidly deploy and win multiple simultaneous large-scale wars and set up an enduring American military presence in the Persian Gulf. Chapter 5 admits that this transformation would take a long time absent some catastrophic and catalyzing event like a new Pearl Harbor. The 2000 Republican National Convention nominates George W. Bush for president and Dick Cheney as vice president, and began a campaign largely funded by Enron. Although Dick Cheney officially resigned as CEO of Halliburton, he takes a $30 million severance package and retains $400,000 worth of Halliburton stock options. During the 2000 election, Florida Governor Jeb Bush paid $4 million to Choice Point Database Technologies, where Richard Armitage was a board member, for a faulty felon purge list that illegally prevented over 57,000 mostly black Democrats from voting. Then during the recount, when it looked like Bush was going to lose his 537-vote margin of victory, the Bush family used their influence with the Supreme Court to overstep their legal bounds and stop the recount. This was done while Anthony Scalia had two sons working for the Bush legal team, and Clarence Thomas's wife was working for the Bush campaign, all of which are clear conflicts of interest. President Bush then filled all of his cabinet positions with representatives directly from the oil and defense industries. And according to Treasury Secretary Paul O'Neill, in their very first National Security Council meeting, Bush and Cheney began brainstorming ideas for how to start a war in Iraq. A Freedom of Information Act request filed by Judicial Watch has exposed secret maps drawn up by Cheney's Energy Task Force in March of 2001, detailing Iraq's oil fields, pipelines, tanker terminals, and refineries, with an estimate of exactly how much the conquest of Iraq would be worth and who the highest bidders for these resources would be. Bush and Cheney also reopened pipeline negotiations with the Taliban, but this time the original financial offer was accompanied by threats of military action if the pipeline was not allowed. After several failed meetings with the Taliban in Washington, Berlin, and Islamabad, in August of 2001, the Taliban was told, "You either accept our offer of a carpet of gold, or we will bury you under a carpet of bombs." President Bush then secretly told Pakistan and India that the U.S. would be launching a military strike against Afghanistan before the end of October.
At 1:47 p.m. on September 11, 2001, while aboard Air Force One, Ari Fleischer was asked the following question by Press Briefing Pool. Quote, "Had there been any warnings that the president knew of?" Close quote. Mr. Fleischer answered simply, quote, "No warnings." No warnings. From my simple research using Google on my home computer, I learned that there were plenty of warnings.
Upon taking office, the Bush administration received dozens of detailed warnings of an impending al-Qaeda attack, including reports from France, Germany, Russia, Egypt, Jordan, and our own intelligence agencies. These reports, taken together, clearly warned that in the week of September 9th, commercial airliners would be hijacked and crashed into the World Trade Center and other targets. Attacks of this kind were not unheard of. USA Today reported that NORAD had run exercises before 9/11, simulating suicide hijacking attacks, including from domestic flights, And in October of 2000, Operation Mascal simulated a plane crashing into the Pentagon. So suicide hijackings were known to be a legitimate threat. Yet all of these warnings were systematically blocked, suppressed, or ignored by the Bush
administration. I don't think anybody could have predicted use an airplane as a missile, a hijacked airplane as a missile.
Nobody in our government, at least, and I don't think the prior government that could envision flying airplanes into buildings.
No specific threat involving really domestic operation or involving what happened, obviously, the city's airliner and so forth.
There were no warning signs that I'm aware of.
Do something about.
Isn't it a fact, Dr. Rice, that the August 6th PDB warned against possible attacks in this country? And I ask you whether you recall the title of that PDB.
I believe the title was Bin Laden Determined to Attack Inside the United States.
After the attack, Bush officials then tried to claim that they had not been warned and blamed CIA and FBI incompetence. Although federal crimes prosecutor John Loftus agrees that the pre-9/11 warnings were so extensive that it is not possible for either the CIA or the FBI to claim a defense of incompetence. Instead of investigating the many warnings of an impending Al-Qaeda attack, the Bush administration supposedly issued Directive 199I, directing FBI agents to back off any Bin Laden or Al-Qaeda-related investigation.
This document is marked secret and WF, which means it walked its way out of the Washington Bureau of the FBI. It indicates that before the attack of September 11th, agents had wanted to question two members of a very powerful family for their connections to a suspected terrorist organization, Omar and Abdullah bin Laden. But the agents weren't allowed to. Now, what makes this family so special that they're protected from investigation?
While the validity of the 199 order has been disputed by debunkers, it is also compounded by the testimonies of at least eight other whistleblowers. Former FBI counterterrorism chief John O'Neill resigned from the FBI in August of 2001, stating that his Al-Qaeda investigations were repeatedly obstructed by FBI headquarters and was specifically ordered not to investigate Saudi Al-Qaeda connections because of oil industry interests. He died while doing security at the World Trade Center on September 11th. FBI agent Robert Wright filed public complaint that the FBI headquarters intentionally and repeatedly thwarted his attempts to launch a more comprehensive investigation to identify and neutralize terrorists. FBI Special Agent Harry Sammet, best known for arresting Zacharias Moussaoui, was repeatedly denied permission to search Moussaoui's laptop, which Sammet believed contained vital information about the coming attack. Former Special Agent Colleen Rowley testified in front of the Senate and for the 9/11 Commission, documenting how FBI headquarters mishandled and failed to take action on information that left the U.S. vulnerable to the September 11th attacks. Former FBI translator Sibel Edmonds testified that the FBI had information that an attack using airplanes was being planned before September 11th, and that the FBI headquarters deliberately withheld or distorted these warnings. Attorney General John Ashcroft then issued a gag order against Sibel Edmonds to prevent her from telling her story. U.S. Army Lieutenant Colonel Anthony Schaefer and four other people working on Able Danger had identified the September 11th leader Mohammed Atta and three of the other 9/11 hijackers, but was prevented by Pentagon officials to pass this information on to other intelligence agencies. The Pentagon then ordered the destruction of the 2.5 terabytes of data collected by Able Danger and placed Schaefer on administrative leave to silence him. David Shippers, who was the House impeachment attorney against Bill Clinton, was representing 10 FBI agents in Chicago and Minnesota who had been developing extensive information on the planned 9/11 attack, but FBI headquarters had pulled them off the terrorist investigation and threatened them with prosecution under the National Security Act if they went public. Shippers attempted to help these FBI agents by passing their warnings directly to Attorney General John Ashcroft, but John Ashcroft refused to take his calls. There is also the testimony of FBI informant Randy Glass, who warned the Bush State Department in July of 2001 that a Pakistan insider told him that the World Trade Center was coming down. The State Department contact told him, quote, "You cannot mention any of these things, especially airplanes being used to fly into the World Trade Center." But Randy Glass had not mentioned the airplanes being used in the attack. The Bush State Department knew more about the attack than he did, but did not want the warnings to be made public. Considering all of these testimonies, it's difficult to escape the conclusion that this is evidence of a concerted high-level effort
to obstruct investigations that could have prevented the 9/11 attack. The three officials most often cited for these obstructions were Michael Maltby, Marion Bowman, and Dave Frasca. These men were not only never asked why they had obstructed the investigations, but they all received promotions for their work. In May of 2001, President Bush signed a directive that put Dick Cheney in charge of the Office of National Preparedness, charged with protecting America from domestic attacks involving weapons of mass destruction and managing training exercises throughout all military agencies in preparation for such an attack. It was later revealed that as many as 6 military wargame exercises and emergency training drills were scheduled to happen simultaneously on the morning of September 11th.
The Vigilant Guardian, which was a hijack exercise, a command post exercise, but it involved the insertion of false radar blips onto radar screens in the Northeast Air Defense Sector. In addition, we have a confirmation, thanks to General Richard Myers, who was acting chairman of the Joint Chiefs, who told Richard Clark, as reported in Clark's book, that there was another exercise, Vigilant Warrior, which was, in fact, according to a NORAD source, a live-fly hijack drill being conducted at the same time. With only 8 available fighter aircraft, and they have to be dispatched in pairs, they were dealing with as many as 22 possible hijacks on the day of 9/11, and they couldn't separate the war game exercises from the actual hijacks.
But this was done deliberately, though.
Apparently so, and I will be saying that in my forthcoming book, Crossing the Rubicon, 9/11 and the Decline of American Empire at the End of the Age of Oil. We have done an extensive investigation on that to show that these war game exercises were apparently very well planned by someone who I will show, I believe, was Dick Cheney in the United States government to deliberately confuse FAA, NORAD, and U.S. Air Force fighter response.
Although military officials refused to confirm who it was that scheduled such an unusual number of drills during the very time of the real attack, these drills would clearly be run under the Office of National Preparedness, which was Dick Cheney's jurisdiction. There were already standard operating procedures set in place well before 9/11 concerning how to respond to the hijacking of commercial flights. According to these procedures, as soon as any flight goes off course or loses contact with controllers, the FAA immediately contacts NORAD, who scrambles fighters to intercept. This occurs on a regular basis. From September of 2000 to June 2001, 67 planes steered off course. All 67 times, our air defenses worked as they should and interceptors were launched, usually within about 10 minutes. But in June of 2001, these standard operating procedures were altered to require the approval from Secretary of Defense before NORAD could respond with any potentially lethal support to an emergency call. While the debunkers continued to deny the relevance of this change in procedures, the result was the drop in fighter interceptor scrambles from an average of 7 or 8 a month before the directive to 0 interceptions in the 3 months before 9/11. While most Americans believe that the invasion of Afghanistan was launched as a retaliation for the 9/11 attack, most don't know that the Bush administration had already planned to go to war with the Taliban before 9/11. Condoleezza Rice has confirmed that the plans to invade Afghanistan in October of 2001 were ready for President Bush to sign into action on September 9th, just 2 days before the attack. Although the document NSPD-9 is still classified, the White House admits that this directive called for the military action to eliminate the Taliban and Al-Qaeda, although before 9/11, there was no legal justification for military action against Afghanistan. This means that if the 9/11 attack had not happened, then the Bush administration would not have had either public or congressional approval to use the NSPD-9 war plans by the October launch date. So the logical question is, how could the Bush administration plan for a retaliation of the 9/11 attack if they had no foreknowledge that the attack was about to happen? A standard rule in most criminal investigations is to follow the money trail to find out who is involved. Yet Chapter 5 of the 9/11 Commission report states, To date, the U.S. government has not been able to determine the origin of the money used for the 9/11 attacks. Ultimately, the question is of little practical significance. This is the equivalent of suggesting that a person who hires a hitman to commit a murder is somehow not responsible for the hitman's actions.
One person who is known to be connected to the attack is the former chief of Pakistani intelligence, General Mahmoud Ahmed. According to the FBI, Ahmed approved over $100,000 in wire transfers to lead hijacker Mohammed Atta as payment for the attack. But during the time of the attack, General Ahmed was visiting Washington, where he had meetings with Colin Powell, Richard Armitage, CIA Director George Tenet, Porter Goss, and other Bush administration officials.
Now the question you have to ask yourself is, the money man behind 9/11 is in Washington meeting top officials and at the same time sending money to the terrorists. Does that not suggest that senior Bush officials should at least give us some answers of what they were doing with this guy?
September 10th, the day before the attack, Donald Rumsfeld announces that $2.3 trillion in Pentagon funding is missing and cannot be accounted for. The comptroller, who was in charge of the Pentagon's budget at this time, was Dov Zakheim, who was a defense contractor specializing in electronic warfare technology, including remote control aircraft systems, and was a member of the Project for a New American Century group. Ordinarily, an announcement like this would have been a huge scandal, but the story was soon forgotten in the events of the next day. It's relevant to point out that one of the areas hit by the Pentagon crash was the operations office of the Army's Financial Management Branch, and destroyed the Pentagon's financial records being housed there. Civilian auditor for the Army, Michael Nielsen, told researcher Barbara Honegger that the operations office may have been targeted because of the missing money. Later on September 10th, a group of top Pentagon officials suddenly canceled their travel plans for the next morning because of concerns about their security. September 11th, 2001, the day of the attack. Air traffic controllers are aware of the first hijacking at about 8:15 a.m. At first, there is confusion if the hijackings are real or if they are part of the multiple military exercises going on at this time.
Hi, Boston Center Team New. We have a problem here. We have a hijacked aircraft headed towards New York. We need someone to scramble some F-16s or something up there to help us out.
Is this real world or exercise?
No, this is not an exercise manifest.
But there are three conflicting official stories as to what happened next. The first story, given to us by Vice President Cheney and General Myers, claims that no military aircraft were scrambled to intercept the hijackings until after the Pentagon was hit. The second story, given to us by NORAD, claims that F-15s were scrambled from Otis at 8:44 and F-16s were scrambled from Langley at 9:30. We know that none of these scrambled fighters made it to their targets in time, but maybe they could have if they weren't flying at only one quarter of their top speed. Then a third conflicting timeline was given to us by the 9/11 Commission. Although the 9/11 report goes on to blame the critical delay in air defense response on NORAD and FAA incompetence, confusion, and failure to follow standard procedures, not one person is reprimanded or otherwise disciplined for their actions. It should be noted that in the hours after the attack, a group of the six air traffic controllers who were dealing with the hijacked flights sat down to make a tape recording describing their experience. It was later revealed that this tape was purposely destroyed by an FAA manager. How could this action not be considered an illegal act of destroying evidence? Who did that tape incriminate?
We should be able to determine through government records who gave the command to scramble the jets from Langley instead of Andrews, which apparently was a critical mistake, and follow the chain of command upwards from that command to find out who is accountable for the NORAD blunder.
Oddly enough, during the most critical time of the attack, almost all of our military chain of command were either absent from duty or were unavailable to take command. The most conspicuous of these absences was Secretary of Defense Don Rumsfeld, who claims he was making phone calls and was completely unaware of the attack until the Pentagon was hit at about 9:37. At that time, Rumsfeld went outside to help move wounded personnel to the triage,
when it was his duty to contact NORAD and take command of the situation. This would have left Vice President Dick Cheney in charge of the U.S. military defenses.
If the Vice President was in the operation room, he was in charge, in a sense. He was in communication with the President as quickly as he could be. Cheney was in the key position at the time.
While the 9/11 Commission report asserts Cheney's time of arrival at the PEOC bunker at 9:37, this is contradicted by Norman Netta, Condoleezza Rice, Karl Rove, Richard Clark, White House photographer David Borer, and ABC, BBC, and the Wall Street Journal, who placed Cheney at the PEOC bunker by 9:20. But something else came out in the testimony of Secretary of Transportation Norman Netta, who was with Cheney in the PEOC bunker as Flight 77 closed in on the Pentagon.
During the time then, the airplane coming in to the Pentagon, there was a young man who would come in and say to the Vice President, the plane is 50 miles out, the plane is 30 miles out. And when it got down to the plane is 10 miles out, the young man also said to the Vice President, do the orders still stand? And the Vice President turned and whipped his neck around and said, of course the orders still stand. Have you heard anything to the contrary?
According to this testimony, Cheney was aware for at least 10 minutes beforehand that the Pentagon was in danger, yet took no action to warn the Pentagon or intercept the incoming craft, opening speculation of a stand-down order. And in reference to United Flight 93, Dick Cheney's version of when he issued shoot-down authorization is directly contradicted by Richard Clark and the heads of NEADS, NORAD, and NMCC, again opening up speculation on whether or not United 93 was shot down. President Bush has publicly stated that on the morning of September 11th, before he began his photo op in the Sarasota schoolroom, that he watched the first plane hit the North Tower on television.
I was sitting outside the classroom waiting to go in, and I saw an airplane hit the tower TV was obviously on, and I used to fly myself, and I said, well, there's one terrible pilot.
But this is impossible, since the footage of the first plane hitting the towers was not broadcast until the next day. But the real mystery is why President Bush, after being told our nation was under attack by Andrew Card, continued to sit and read with the children at this publicly scheduled event. It can safely be assumed that during an attack on the United States, that the president would be considered a prime target. Yet the president's security team made no effort whatsoever to move to a safe, undisclosed location. Even after leaving the classroom, Bush remained at the school to hold a live press conference, once again confirming his location to the public. How could President Bush or his security team assume that the president was not an intended target of the attack? By 10 o'clock on the morning of 9/11, a state of national emergency had been declared, which activated the COG, continuity of government plans, that Dick Cheney and Don Rothschild have been developing since the 80s.
As of September the 11th, the entire country went into continuity of government, which is a special government that does not rely on the elected representatives, but in fact puts a small group of people in power. When you go into a declared war or a state of national emergency, which is what they went into on September 11th, legal authorities change. Hundreds of laws allow new power and new authorities for a select few people. Decisions are made in, not by the overt government, but by now an acknowledged shadow government. That's who's making these decisions, is DOD, FEMA, and the NSA. That's who's running the country since September 11th.
This plan allows the executive branch to bypass constitutional oversight and would explain the Bush administration's complete disregard for due process.
They have taken the attitude at the White House that somehow they're above the law. That if they make a decision that something they want to do, nobody should question them on it. The Vice President's even been quoted as saying the courts can't question it, the Congress can't question it. That's a Nixonian attitude, and it's wrong. In America, no one is above the law. The president and the vice president are not above the law any more than you and I are.
Although the original plans had a 2-year limitation, the
This national emergency directive has been quietly renewed over the past 9 years and was last renewed by President Obama on September 10th, 2009.
Fundamental rights of free expression are being, again, also rescinded. People are being arrested arbitrarily for presumed links to the terrorists, when in fact the people who have ordered these arrests themselves have links to the terrorists. That's the question we have to ask. And that's what defines the criminalization of the state. It's when war criminals call the shots and decide who are criminals.
On 9/11, Secretary of Transportation Norm Mineta ordered a ban on all private domestic flights. Yet the Bush White House allowed a jet to violate this ban in order to transport members of the Bin Laden and Saudi royal family out of the U.S. before they could be questioned by legal authorities. A standard procedure at any crime scene is to save any forensic evidence for examination. Specifically, NFPA Section 936 states, once evidence has been removed from the scene, it should be maintained and not destroyed or altered until others who have a reasonable interest in the matter have been notified. Yet only days after the attack, the city of New York accepted a plan to immediately ship the steel from the World Trade Center site overseas to be melted down and recycled.
What happened to the crime scene? They took it away. They shipped it to New Jersey, and then the steel, because if you investigate steel, you can see if there's anything, other components, or what caused the meltdown. The steel has been shipped over to China.
A similar disregard for evidence was seen at the Pentagon.
Shortly after the strike, government agents picked up debris and carried it off. The entire lawn was covered with dirt and gravel, so that any remaining forensic evidence was literally covered up.
This amounts to the willful destruction of critical evidence before investigation. In a deceptive effort to keep New York's financial markets open, the White House blocked warnings from the EPA about the health hazards in the air around the cleanup site, as Christine Todd Whitman knowingly issued false statements saying the air was safe to breathe. As a result, now hundreds of rescue and cleanup workers are sick and dying from preventable respiratory ailments. Within hours after the attack, the FBI claimed to know the identities of all 19 Al-Qaeda terrorists after discovering Mohammed Atta's luggage, which had miraculously not been loaded onto his flight. Among the items contained in Atta's luggage were instructions to his fellow hijackers, along with his passport, driver's license, and will. Now, why would Atta have brought these things onto a flight that he knew would be destroyed in a fiery crash? More evidence incriminating the 19 men was left behind in their rented car. Why, after eluding authorities for so long, would they leave such an obvious trail of evidence for authorities to find? Did no one suspect that this evidence may have been planted to implicate a group of predetermined scapegoats? More suspicions should have been raised when several of the men named and pictured as the hijackers were reported to be alive and well, complaining that their identities had been stolen. When FBI Director Robert Mueller was faced with these anomalies, he publicly admitted that some of the hijackers could have been using stolen identities, yet the same 19 suspects have continued to be cited as the guilty hijackers. The public was also convinced that these 19 hijackers were willing to commit suicide in their mission because they were radical Islamic fundamentalists. Yet in the months before the attack, they were reported eating pork, drinking heavily in bars, frequenting strip clubs, and sleeping with prostitutes. This is not the behavior of religious men seeking salvation in the afterlife. So who were they?
Amazing is when you stop and consider that everyone that they say was involved in the attack, the Al-Qaeda network, Osama bin Laden, these are creations of our intelligence agencies. The Al-Qaeda people, they're called a terrorist network. I think they would be more correctly termed a mercenary, Arab mercenaries.
Means that Al-Qaeda is being used to perform certain functions for the U.S. Intelligence apparatus.
Our enemy is a radical network of terrorists and every government that supports them.
A Immediately after the attacks, several statements were reportedly released by Osama bin Laden, saying, "I would like to assure the world that I did not plan the recent attacks, which seem to have been planned by people for personal reasons." Despite this claim of innocence, the Bush administration continued with their Afghan war plans, saying the United States would make no distinction between the terrorists and the states that harbor them. The Taliban responded by agreeing to extradite bin Laden to the custody of a third country on the condition that the U.S. provide hard evidence of bin Laden's involvement in the 9/11 attack. Instead, President Bush rejected this offer, saying there's no need to discuss innocence or guilt. We know he's guilty, and proceeded to invade Afghanistan. Then in December of 2001, the Pentagon released a video they claim was found in an abandoned shack in Jalalabad, supposedly of Osama bin Laden confessing to the attack. While the American press continues to cite this video as proof of bin Laden's guilt, a closer look at the video shows this man has darker skin, a wider face, a shorter nose, and is clearly in much better health than the real bin Laden, who is gaunt and frail, undergoing dialysis treatments for his failing kidneys. Dr. Bruce Lawrence, widely considered this country's leading bin Laden expert, has denounced this video as bogus, saying friends of his in the U.S. Department of Homeland Security also know that it's bogus. In fact, in June of 2006, Rex Toom, chief of investigative publicity for the FBI, was asked why there was no mention of 9/11 on bin Laden's Most Wanted webpage. Toom said, "The reason why 9/11 is not mentioned on Osama bin Laden's Most Wanted page is because the FBI has no hard evidence connecting bin Laden to 9/11. While this shocking admission should have been front-page news, the mainstream media made no mention of it, and to this day, Osama bin Laden has still not been formally indicted and charged in connection with 9/11. Despite the still-repeated claim that the invasion of Afghanistan was justified to apprehend Osama bin Laden for 9/11, according to Gary Burnson, the CIA officer who tracked bin Laden through the mountains of Afghanistan, bin Laden was allowed to escape Tora Bora into Pakistan because the U.S. command refused to send requested troops.
In the wake of the attacks, eyewitnesses told Britain's The Daily Telegraph that they were shocked that the U.S. had surrounded Tora Bora only on three sides. Bin Laden walked out of the Tora Bora cave complex and into Pakistan with a number of loyal followers.
U.S. forces also stood down as hundreds more al-Qaeda members escaped capture from Kunduz by a Pakistani airlift.
It had to be done with the blessing of Musharraf, didn't
exactly,
it?
Exactly, and of the United States.
When I tell you it comes at the level of Don Rumsfeld, it has to.
No plane could fly from Kunduz to Pakistan without getting shot down unless we let it happen. And we let it happen, and I think there's just no other way to explain it.
My take on it basically is the fact that there is some sort of a deal in place between the government of Pakistan and the United States.
The Taliban was quickly overthrown, and America appointed Afghanistan's new leader as Hamid Karzai, a CIA asset who helped fund the Mujahideen in the 80s, along with Special Envoy Zalmay Khalilzad, who worked for UNICAL during the original pipeline negotiations. Within a year, the $3.2 billion deal for the proposed pipeline through Afghanistan was signed. The next step for the Bush administration was to extend the war on terror to Iraq, and the easiest way to do that was to try to connect Iraq to 9/11. But when no genuine link was found, Bush and Cheney attempted to fabricate one.
It's the book by author Ron Suskind and charges that the Bush White House ordered up a fake letter from Saddam Hussein's chief of intelligence linking Iraq with the 9/11 attack and with an ongoing nuclear program, neither of which was true.
Intelligence gathered by this and other governments leaves no doubt that the Iraqi regime continues to possess and conceal some of the most lethal weapons ever devised.
The repeated claims of weapons of mass destruction and the promise that the next 9/11 attack will bring a mushroom cloud was a threat that the still frightened public could not ignore, but the administration's true goal was apparent.
I don't really think the weapons of mass destruction were the sole reason for the war.
In February 2003, White House spokesman Ari Fleischer announced our new crusade.
Among aspects of Operation Iraqi Liberation,
Operation Iraqi Liberation.
Subliminal messages. I don't think we need to be subliminal.
Afghanistan and Iraq are the two opening engagements in what are bound to be a long series of wars and international contests over the remaining oil in the world.
And then he spoke directly to the Iraqi people.
Listen carefully to this warning. Do not destroy oil wells.
Bush knew Iraq committed no crime against this country. He ordered the most awesome army on earth to open fire on innocent men, women, and children in the middle of the night. Bush ordered this massacre, which by early 2004 had killed over 10,000 innocent Iraqis.
All of these reports from the Arab media saying hundreds of women and children have been killed. Marines on the ground saying they're not attacking civilians, but the ground truth is the Pentagon does not keep a civilian casualty count, and we don't really know how many civilians have died. All they can say is that Al Jazeera and Al Arabiya are covering it.
Bush had to sell the American people the big lie, and the American people had to buy it to justify this ruthless attack upon a defenseless, defeated country ruled by a dictator which the CIA and his father had helped stay in power.
Those weapons of mass destruction got to be somewhere. Nope, no weapons over there.
With two wars raging, the floodgates were opened for military spending as billions of dollars in no-bid contracts were divided up amongst the friends of the administration, many of which were already found guilty of fraud and corruption. Thus, the transformation of America was complete, from a peaceful time of comparative prosperity to a war economy marked by corporate greed, loss of civil liberties, and financial hardships for the American people as we bury our fallen soldiers. All of this information taken together builds a compelling case that the key members of the Bush administration, specifically Cheney, Bush, Rumsfeld, and their close associates, at the very least, knew the 9/11 attack was coming and allowed it to happen so they could implement their plans of war for oil and profit. These men had a clear motive for the attack, were in a position to facilitate the attack, and are implicated by evidence of obstructing the investigation into the attack. One must only ask why this information has never been presented to the public.
The hardest thing to accomplish right now is to get America's attention away from, you know, recreational shopping at the mall and Jennifer Lopez and playing computer games and NFL football and NASCAR and all their other current preoccupations.
Reality is bad for business. What's good for business is the fantasy.
We're happily existing in that bubble of the consensus trance. The idea that everything's okay and everybody agrees that everything's okay.
Why is it that even the Democratic leadership has been protecting these men? When Nancy Pelosi became Speaker of the House in 2006, why did she immediately declare impeachment of Bush and Cheney was off the table and actively hindered attempts from fellow Democrats to begin legal proceedings? Why, when Obama continually spoke out against the Bush administration's actions while he was on the campaign trail, did he decide not to pursue any case against them, saying that we should not dwell on the past? Or do you think the real reason why they're not holding the Bush administration accountable is that a full investigation would uncover corruption on both sides of the political aisle? But we cannot allow partisan politics to distract us from the fact that nearly 3,000 innocent people were murdered, and the 9/11 Commission admits we were not told the truth about it. For the sake of the victims, and for their families, and for the safety and freedom of all Americans, we need to reopen the 9/11 investigation now.